And Harvard is a, I don't know if it's still up and running, but a famous jazz club in Harlem, in New York City. There's famous stories about American jazz groups coming to allies of the morning. The maple syrup part of what we're talking about. And remember, it's again under that whole umbrella of art. So we've got music at play, we've got literary art at play, and we're also going to look at the poem that I posted up on Moodle and do some work with that today. And we're going to talk some more about just kids and go back to what we started working on last time. Some quotes. And then in the last part of class, we're going to look at memory growth. So the first part, a couple of announcements. First of all, I want to remind, welcome back those of you who took President's Day. Welcome back. We're kind of skeleton crew in here. There's stuff we went over on Monday that you can't get back. It's going to be on the third. Here's the thing about attendance. We're going to remind you what the attendance policy is. You get three free absences. And 20% of your grade is attendance and participation. And that part of your grade, if you exceed three absences, will drop by half a grade for each day you miss beyond three. Right? The other thing, this is a little bit of a strange experience for me, teaching up to our stage, and there's, 600 or 700 of you in here, in a smaller classroom, I have a lot more sense of where you all are in terms of your presence and your preparation and your participation and how engaged you are in the class. So I'm getting reports from the TAs that there's a chatter going on in parts of the classroom. That some students' learning here has been disrupted by other students, and that can't go on. So, this other work, I've given the TAs and kind of full authorization. I know sometimes you are engaged and interested in talking about what you're saying, what you're hearing. Just one of the TAs just going around and asked you to be quiet. That's your one and only warning. And that's the time to have my full authorization to this message in the past. This is the NSA policy under disruptive students. You can look it up. If you get dismissed, you're not present here. That constitutes your attendance. Right? In addition to that, before you get to come back to class, you need to go talk to your TA to talk about classroom comportment. So your TA may send you a mood. Right? If you're up for that job, smack your head. The other thing we're going to do today, we've got all the material to work with. And I understand that getting back to the main campus, if you're not to class, or whatever you got going on at 10 o'clock, is a trial for some of you. I'm saying this with a little bit of sarcasm in my voice because I went to the University of Washington in Seattle for all of my schooling. Student parking was down in this huge parking lot called Montlake Parking Lot. And it took about 20 minutes to get from Montlake Parking Lot up to Main Campus. There was no public transportation, there's no train system up the, coming to the space to Main Campus. The stories about the difficulty of getting from this part of campus on to the other part of campus, how much sympathy is needed. So it's like the stories, your grandfather or, whoever that figure is tells about, having to walk in the snow to school 20 miles uphill both ways, right? Anyway, so here's the deal. No break today. We're going to go straight to the 9:45, and I'll let you go there, all right? One of the things we're going to do, and I like to do this, I like to have students read aloud. And so I'm going to walk around, and those of you who don't have your books, you're going to be the ones I ask to read aloud. You have to borrow a book from some of our houses. So raise your hand if you do have a book. Alright, you guys don't have to read aloud, but be prepared. Be prepared to learn your book. Let me ask this question. The quiz for this section of the course is on Monday, and you have 24 hours to log on, and I think it's an hour to take the quiz. Well, 24 hours to log on to the quiz and take it from, I think, 12 o'clock noon on Monday to 12 o'clock noon on Tuesday. That's how it works. So today I've done this once. I'm hoping that it goes smoothly for you. If you do this, however, if you still have questions, or if you have any problems with having problems last time, would you please contact your TA about this process. Likewise, I've been asked to announce about some of the assignments that are being held accountable for. But if you would do this for me, if you would please contact your TA if you're having particular issues with completing your assignment. We'd have to do it to get this sorted out for you. We're not quite halfway through the course, and the grading is in place. That is, you're accumulating points to the grade as you continue. A lot of your patients at the work scores. I don't know how many people send me the post, but they're all coming through my email. So, All right. So we're going to come back to this image. Thank you. talk about images, which we're going to talk about a number of ways here today. These are the topics today. We're going to go back to church. And church, as I said last time, we define church as a twist from a literal use of language. A twist from a literal use of language. And we do it all the time. Right? And it happens all the time. If we think of language in the broad sense, as, you know, gestures, facial expressions, in addition to speaking and writing, then we might take into account, you know, what happened last time. And for those of you who want to hear, you know, it was maybe the funniest moment of the course so far, which is, you know, I was talking about, well, we were all talking about, right, what we did last week, and somebody on their cell phone played the sound of crickets, right? Let's don't do that again. Why is it funny? Why is it funny? No, this is a serious question. Why is that funny? And it's because that sound communicates something like language, right? It's not just literally the sound of crickets, because then we would think, but that insect's already a mile long. And we, you know, some of us might even be verified. My mom, for instance, I didn't say it's my friend, my mom, for instance, hated crickets. And we get crickets into the house sometimes, and she wouldn't let my dad go to sleep until he found a cricket. But that's a literal cricket, right? And we're all laughing at this because it means something else, right? And when it was played last time, it was in reference to my referring to, you know, what you all did last weekend. And so I understood the joke to be, didn't do anything over the weekend. It was crickets. It was silent, right? That's the joke. Am I getting it right? Is that the joke? No, okay, so someone explained the joke to me. What's the joke? Someone please. Don't worry. It's not me. What's that? It's Cory in here? Alright. But the crickets communicate something else, doesn't it? Right? It's not about insects hopping around in here making noises. That would be the literal meaning. And by playing the sound of crickets on the cell phone, there's a quote that play, right? Some of those crickets mean something else. Apparently it meant boredom. Right? Crickets mean boredom. And suddenly we're in the realm of metaphor, aren't we? Because crickets literally don't signify boredom. Only metaphorically, right? That's a quote. So I mean by the twist in language. The sound of crickets haven't always meant boredom. But they didn't mean that for me growing up. And, you know, I would say that notion has come into language. We all kind of understood that in the last, I'd say within the last 10 years, maybe the last 5. Language changes. The use of language changes. Like art, like education. Like the notion of family. The other thing we're going to work on today is make a book art, and this will go into next time. So we you could come in here before the images and talk about how to place them in the tradition of fine art, visual art. So, we're going to mix things up in terms of thinking about language and the language in just kids and the writing in just kids with images. So, in part, I'm asking you to think, in addition to the written word and the spoken word in language, I'm going to ask you to think about photographs. And in a couple of cases, painting in terms of language. It's a long tradition of thinking about art, that art speaks, right? Of course, that's another metaphor, because pictures don't literally enunciate. Some art critics would say, art theorists would say, well, pictures are comprised of kind of visual language. Images have a set of symbols that communicate. All right? So, we move from image. We're going to talk about literary images today, or images in language, or images in the written word, as well as images, visual images. One way to think about how we move to metaphor in language is we move from images to symbols to metaphor. And that kind of progression. So we'll start with image. A literary image, we say, is language in a text that appeals to our senses. Sight, smell, and taste, and all of those senses. And it's an odd thing, but those of us who read novels regularly, those of us who read poetry, some of us would say, well, this is why I do it. I do it for the sensory pleasure of doing it. I refer to my senses. There actually aren't very many books that literally tap into our sense of smell, is it? Is it? I suppose, you know, you could say, well, there's this Scratch and Sniff things that are in magazines, right, for perfume. That's all I'm talking about here. And it's the same with the other senses, too, of literary images. There's a disconnect between language and what's actually happening with our sensory apperception. That's a literary image. Another kind of image that is perhaps more obvious is the sense of visual imagery. Let's go back to the Mapplethorpe photograph. Right? Now, let's do these fairly quickly. But I'm guessing you picked it up right away. But they're sort of mirrors, right? And these images do a lot of things. And there's kind of a joke at play, right? And the joke is that we have Mapplethorpe's hand, apparently. These are titled by Mapplethorpe self-portraits. Both of these. Both in the same year. So, we're led to think this is Mapplethorpe's hand. And he's written pictures. Pictures. With tapped into the idea of a literary image, right? Because the word pictures isn't actually a visual image. It's a literary image. And now we're in some sort of space where there's a little bit of a joke being played on it. A visual joke, as it were. So, the hand placement is roughly the same, and it looks like it's the same pad of paper, and that whatever one of these images was taken first, a neighbor for it. He didn't actually rewrite out pictures. He didn't actually rewrite out pictures for the second one, because the writing is precisely the same. Right? Something else going on here, just in addition to the visual joke and the fact that we've got visual images up here. And that is the difference between the clothing here, which looks perhaps something like the clothing I'm wearing today. And clothing is part of that language system too, right? Clothing, the clothes we wear to speak. I think I'm probably one of the only people, young man up in the front row here, very nice dress and a coat and tie. And maybe he and I are the only two people in coats and ties in the room today. And it says something. It says that, oh, what's the matter? Please tell me. And it says something, right? It speaks something different than those of us who came in sweatshirts today, and hoodies. Right? What we wear says something. In fact, some of you are wearing clothes that literally say something, right? That literally has text. I can look out over there and maybe you're representing Sonoma State. Represent. Sonoma State. You. Sonoma State University. Right? They're walking advertisements. They're at a university. Well done. I love New York. Another one. I love New York. A statement. I love New York. I heart New York. Even those of us who are wearing clothes that don't have writing on them, it is saying something, right? And it does that not always in the case of literally saying something. But we know that the way that what on these two arms represents, it signifies differently, right? We could probably play that game in magazines, and I forget that children's magazines, things like Highlighter or something like that. It's like, what's the difference between the two pictures, right? They know the difference between the two pictures, right? But the one obvious difference is what's on this list, what's not on this list, what's on this list, and what's not on this list. That hand has a leather glove. His hand is not, right? And it's already reading for us metaphorically. It's already reading metaphorically. And it's a self-portrait, and it begins to suggest something about Robert Mapplethorpe's work. And what the rest of his work also brings into play that we're going to see over the next few passages. So we move from image to symbol to metaphor. or gave you the different definition of image. Symbol in literature and in the world is an object, a sign, or an image that stands in, usually in a one-for-one kind of relationship for some idea. And so we all know that the American flag is a symbol for a whole set of things, like patriotism, freedom, liberty, justice for all, equality, rights, liberty, pursuit of happiness. And in fact, that's a sad school for countries, for high schools, universities. When you all graduate, Sonoma State University, what a really great commencement here. Fabulous commencement. Graduation's a great day, most of the time it's sunny. Your parents and friends come to you graduate. And your professors, administrators, dress in regalia. You graduate and you get dressed in your bachelor's degree, regalia, cap and gown. And then there's these banner carriers that carry the banner to Sonoma State University. And the banners are sort of light blue and white. And then the program every year it explains what those banners are assembled for. What they're assembled for. Right? So we all understand what a symbol is. Sometimes symbols are more complicated, right? I mean, how is it, well, it's not, they're complicated just on the face of it. I mean, how is it that these pieces of cloth that are dyed blue, white, and red suddenly stand in for all of the things that the American flag is supposed to stand for? In the 1980s, there was this whole controversy about burning the American flag. And it became this big political issue. And literally, it's just Trump, but I mean, literally with a degree, it's just Trump. But the Congress of the United States and the President of the United States at the time, the first George Bush president, were motivated to pass a law, a constitutional amendment against burning flags. And then there was this event at Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles where, as a kind of protest, some fan jumped out of the stands with an American flag and lit it on fire. And Rick Monday, playing out there, going out there and save the American flag being burned, right? That's how our symbols are. That's how our symbols can become. Photographs that are black and white, mainly photographs of flowers. And those flowers take on a kind of meaning other than just the beauty of being flowers. So let's start with a couple of photographs of flowers that he did of calla lilies. Calla lilies, those of you who are going to get married someday, one of the number top five wedding flowers. And part of it is just because they're so elegant and beautiful. They're these completely white flowers, a uniform that cooked. They hurt up all day, even if it's a hot day when you get married in July. In the year 2018, 2020. Because they stay there and they hurt up a bit, because they symbolize something. And they symbolize grace, and arrogance, and innocence, the white, big, beautiful power lilies. Power lilies also symbolize death. Death and rebirth after death. Possibility to rebirth after death. And we already know this, right? We already know this about flowers and what they symbolize. So within a week, the day when some of you, perhaps all of you, how many people gave or received roses on Valentine's Day? Raise your hand, because it's that time, right? And roses are lovely. I heard someone recently say, I hate roses. One of my students said, I hate roses. I hate roses. I thought, really? Roses are lovely. Roses are great. But they actually haven't become a cliche, have they? Otherwise, they wouldn't sell. They wouldn't sell so well on Valentine's Day. Because all they are, literally, is this biological thing. That's all they are. Right? It's just, you know, this far removed from being a weed, right? They go really well in Sonoma County, by the way. But you get roses, or you give roses to someone, I don't know what it symbolizes, especially if they're red roses. You get a dozen red roses, or two dozen red roses. Or if you really love you, you get five dozen scattered all over your bedroom. It's lovely. I love you. She loves me. Right? That's what symbolizes love. And it works. Right? You love it. It's a great thing. Give roses to someone. Don't be shy about that. Do it. Do it. Alright, that's symbols. You got symbols? And we move from images to symbols to metaphors. Metaphors, by definition, are implied analogies. We say that similes, the close cousin of metaphor, that's S-I-M-I-L-E, are distinguished from metaphor because similes are not implied comparisons. They use like or as, right? So when I say, or Robert Bryant said it first, the Scottish poet, my love is like a red, red rose. It's like a red, red rose. He's engaging in the use of simile, a close cousin to a metaphor. Not literally, because, you know, words can't be cousins to other words. But metaphorically, simile, see I'm doing this, simile is a close cousin to a metaphor. And usually, the analogy or the comparison is between two unlike things. The last time we talked here briefly about broken hearts, right? Broken hearts. Now, we know literally one heart doesn't break. What it feels like when it happens. It's your heart. Biologists among us would say just that organ in the body that keeps the blood flowing through your system, right? That's all it is. You need it. It doesn't really break. Even if you have a heart attack, it's not really broken. A broken heart, the metaphor means something else. In this case, that the heart is standing in metaphorically for the seat of our emotional reality, right? And when you have a broken heart, it means that, your emotional reality has been torn apart. It's crashed. Tell your stories. Walk around, moving around, the days, the weeks. Those are fresh. Just like that, those things. A bubbly personality. Life of the party, that bubbly personality. You want him there. Can men have bubbly personalities? Is that assigned to women? I'm asking that question rhetorically. And I'm asking it because this is where metaphors take on their complexity. Suddenly, I move from, being the life of the party, which, that isn't gender specific. A bubbly personality, maybe bubbly personality is. I don't really know. It'd be okay if someone called me a bubbly personality after you took the phone. You could call me a wallflower. Not literally, a character. Metaphors do lots of things in language. There was a time when critics thought that metaphors just decorated language, that language in its most proper usage was literal, and that metaphors were added on as decorative. But it turns out that metaphors constitute how we use language. We use metaphors all the time. And metaphors, especially when properly used, give our language usage power. I like being Wisconsin, but I grew up in California, and when I got to drive at Sonoma State, I thought I'd die. But I was that happy to come back to California and to live in one of the most beautiful places in the world. Things that I realized when I came back and started teaching here at Sonoma State is that Sonoma State students had a better understanding for some reason of irony than the counterpart, your counterpart that I taught at the University of Wisconsin. You're good irony, right? Well, use it. service that I offer? That's not going to be quite lying, right? What kind of service that I offer? It's a trick. It's a twist on language that changes language's literal meaning into its opposite, right? That's how irony works. Ironically, I thought that Cricket was about your weekend, and it turned out it was about me, back on me. Ironically. There's a better irony there. So just some examples of irony here. I saw a fish drowning, right? Many things can be preserved in alcohol. Dignity is not one. Marriage is the leading cause of divorce. Not very many people go into marriage and I will get divorced. I'm going to get married thinking my true love forever. There's a kind of irony isn't always about just being funny, right? It is supposed to be the same as the end of divorce, and ironically, it is also literally the case that marriage is the leading cause of divorce, the end of marriage. Because you have to get married to a divorce, you can't get a divorce unless you get married. And this is to say, and this is probably a large enough example, as things change between now and 2018, when the first of you starts getting married, but you aren't married yet, unless things change, that 50% of you who get married are going to get divorced. That's more literal than a statistic, right? But there's an irony that the very thing that we do forever. And there's 15 minutes on this, so I can respond to it. Okay, so I put Patti Smith's song from Horses Land. I uploaded it on Tomato. I think I looked at it. I don't have it in the mood. I'm only glad not having your eyes. I'm going to play a little bit of it today, but I want us to think about the lyrics, which are Patti Smith's lyrics. I'm going to put these up here first. This is the first stanza. And let's go through this whole image, symbol, metaphor. Now, let's start with images here, right? The title would suggest that we've got something else going on here. Because the song, if you look at all the lyrics, and I've uploaded this onto Moodle, doesn't say so much about any land, any geographical land. It doesn't use the word land as a verb, like to land a plane or to land on your feet. So, the title seems to be engaged in some sort of metaphorical usage that we'd have to figure out. But at this point, when you see this much of the text, of the lyrics, I was kind of impressed when I was rereading it again last night to come up with, well, what do I do with just this much text except to talk about the images? And we can do the images all day, right? The boy was in the hallway drinking a glass of tea. And we might ask, well, what boy? But at this point, we're glad to say, well, it's the boy. And drink a glass of tea. That's pretty straightforward. Glass of tea. And so the other end of the hallway, a rhythm was generating. Another boy was sliding up the hallway. Maybe that's brittle. Maybe there's another boy just sliding up the hallway. Or maybe sliding is some sort of metaphorical use of sliding. We can get an image from that, right? What that might look like in our head. The mirror in the hallway. Well, perhaps literally there's a mirror in the hallway, or perhaps this second boy, this another boy, is a kind of mirror for the first boy drinking glass of tea. And this is what poetry does. Poetry gets us to think about the text in multiple ways. Doesn't have to give up meaning right away, or at all, in some cases. So let's see what happens to this set of images and half-formed metaphors in the song. I'll try to keep up with it. This is how we're going to go into it. Opening images from the first stanza shift into something else altogether. Lyrically. And in that second stanza that I threw up there, the two boys in that first stanza engaged apparently in either some violent sexual act or some consensual sexual act is unclear. With the rhythm of the song and the rhythm that's introduced in stanza one into rock and roll and all of these references to classic rock and roll songs like The Twist, Chubby Checker, or Phony Maloney, and it goes on. If we kept playing it, the list would just go on. There's all kinds of things that are there in terms of imagery, a metaphor, symbolism, right? But this section of the text together. And we're going to do it by reading some of this aloud. So, the second paragraph in begins at 20 years old, I boarded the bus. So we're going to start there. All right. We didn't have any books back there. No books back there. Where's he? All right. Where's the reading book? Where's the book? At 20 years old, I boarded the bus. I wore my dungarees, black turtleneck, and my old gray raincoat I had bought in Kansas. My small suitcase, yellow and red plate, had some drawing pencils, a notebook, illuminations, a few pieces of clothing, and pictures of my siblings. I was superstitious. Today was a Monday. I was born on Monday. It was a good day to arrive in New York City. No one expected me. Everything awaited me. Well done, I think. Well read. All right. Let's start with some images. We got some other microphones going around. That passage that RJ read so finely. There's lots of images in there, right? What does it begin with? What do we see in our minds? The past, I heard. What else? Yeah. Okay. Suitcase, right? There's a suitcase on the bus. What else? Day of the week. I guess that's an image, right? Okay. Yeah, so that's going to move to the level of metaphor, right? And she's going to do that work for us as a writer. She's going to say, well, it was a Monday. Monday was the day I was born. It's beginning, right? And that's at the level of metaphor. What's your name? Ryan? Ryan, you just moved us from image all the way off to metaphor. Because Monday isn't just the beginning of the work week. Or for some of you this week, a holiday that wasn't a holiday on the campus calendar. I know. And some of you actually were set. But Monday, in this case, is the beginning of something, right? It's a good day to arrive in New York City. No one expected me. Everything awaited me. That's all speaking to beginnings, right? Subway from the Port Authority, goes up to J Street, and goes to see some friends. She walks into the room, and there's this boy sleeping. And she goes on, decides to wait for a chance to meet know this one boy. So, how about over in this section? You don't have a breath today. I'll put it there in a second. What's that bell? Come here. Thomas. Can't let you read on page 26. The paragraph that begins the day one on, right at the top. Now, just down to the staff here, the math at it. Just that first bell. Can you do that?
Yeah.
Want to stand up? Hey! Thomas, you want Thomas to stand?
The day I wore on, I waited for my friends. I searched and would hope they did not return. That night, having nowhere to go, I fell asleep on their red street. When I awoke, it was Independence Day, my first day away from home with the familiar parade, weddings, picnics, and fireworks display. I felt a restless agitation in the air. Packs of children threw firecrackers that exploded at my feet. I would spend that day, much as I spent the next few weeks, looking for kindred souls, shelter, and my surgeons urgently a job. Summer seemed the wrong time to find a sympathetic soup. Everyone was desperately eager to provide me with a helping hand. Everyone was struggling, and I, the country mouse, was just an awkward peasant. Eventually, I went back to the city and slept in Central Park, not far from the statue of an icon.
Thank you, gentlemen. Well done. Okay. We've got symbols, we've got metaphors, we've got irony. We're paying attention. So let's start with the images. After being thrown at his feet, right? That's a pretty vivid image, right? Right? Probably we see that happen at our own 4th of July parties and gatherings, right? Let's come back to that one, the 4th of July. It's another image. Yeah. The statue of the Mad Hatter, right? Okay? The red stoop that he stopped on. Good. Symbol. That one-to-one correspondence. You guys already said it, right? It's the 4th of July, right? And the 4th of July, she calls it by its proper name, which is what? Independence Day. Is that a symbol? What's the symbol of? Hell yeah. Hella symbol, right? Hella symbol. Hecka, I guess it is. Come on up here in North Carolina. Hell symbol. So it's a symbol for Independence Day. It's a symbol for America, right? And what else? I heard it. Freedom, right? Independence Day. Freedom, right? And it stands in for all these things. It also stands in for firecrackers being thrown at people's feet. Why firecrackers and Independence Day? Because they're loud. They're celebratory, right? Anything else? Anybody want to give us the history of firecrackers on Independence Day? Well, it's something about this idea of the birth of our nation. birth of America being born out of violence, isn't it? So we had to wrest, apparently, our independence from those excessive English from across the Atlantic. We had to do it through war, right? In fact, our national anthem is about celebrating, you know, the flag, that other symbol, rockets, red glare, bombs bursting through air, right? That's connected metaphorically to this idea of firecrackers, right? We wasn't just loud and throwing people's feet and they blow up things. We buy those illegal ones. But as a symbol, they're about independence. They're about independence being wrested violently. The story goes that we had to do that, historically. We had to do that. And interestingly enough, you know, you all know that our national anthem was written during the War of 1812, 4 years after, you know, the Declaration of Independence, right? Is that right? 50 years later, and we had to do it again. They came back. They burned down the White House, fourth White House, burned to the ground. 1812, right? That was not this national anthem, right? It's about independence, though. There's something else going on here that goes back to the first passage that RJ read so well for us, which is about arising. And it's just a day. July 3rd in New York City, Patti Smith has arrived in this new city, the day before Independence Day. When I awoke, it was Independence Day, not just the Independence Day. Away from home, my first day of independence. Independence, someone said, is about that idea of this country's independence, and how Smith's independence in this case is about that other word that we associate with independence, which is isn't an image, is it? Freedom isn't an image. And it's not really a symbol because it turns out when we're talking about Independence Day and the freedom of, you know, the freedom being in this country, that's different than the kind of freedom that Patti Smith is speaking to you about her Independence Day on her first full day in New York City. Isn't it? So freedom is not an image. We can't see it. We can't taste it. We can't feel it. We can't smell it. We already know it because Patti Smith is describing her own personal freedom. It is distinct from the freedom of being in this country because of what happened in 1776 or 1812, the Black Civil Rights Movement. That's a different order of freedom than that individual freedom that she had. So freedom, then, my friends, must be a rebuttal. It's a metaphor, right? Freedom is a metaphor. And lest we think that freedom is a simple metaphor, or that metaphors are simply decorative. Think how powerful that notion of freedom is, right? Look how powerful it is. Skyscrapers in the rest of the world, but we don't even have the tallest building anymore in the United States of America. Some other country has decided to build one taller. But that doesn't matter. Skyscrapers aren't just buildings, are they? Patty Smith tells us so. But skyscrapers, first of all, are what on this? Well, they're an image, right? She's giving us an image. But then she tells us very quickly, because they're beautiful. That's what they are. They do not seem like mere corporate shells. She's moved all the way to metaphor. I mean, how does a building become a shell? Shells belong on clams and other mollusks, literally. But it's that they're not just mere corporate shell. He's moved to a level of metaphor. They were monuments to the arrogant yet philanthropic spirit of America. So he's telling us what that symbol is. When you all see this set of questions on the quiz, and there will be questions about this passage that we're working through today, you can all say with assurance that skyscrapers are a symbol. They're a symbol. They stand in for something about corporate philanthropy and for America, the part of the landscape of the 20th century, the part of what distinguishes the American landscape in the century that all of us here were born in. And I can only say that for another like 5 years or so. I'm just going to be a new group of students who are born in the 20th century. How strange is that going to be? How strange is that going to be? But for now, I can say of us were born in the 20th century, the century of the skyscraper in America. Just stop for a moment and imagine what San Francisco would look like without skyscrapers, right? Or New York City, without skyscrapers. When I was there, in the early part of the 20th century, this is what people from elsewhere, other countries, said about America. This was one of the distinguishing features about this country. Skyscrapers, New York City, skyscrapers. Amazing thing. She goes on, she meets this person who she calls Saint. My God, she says, and this is on page 27, who's a black Cherokee, she says, with one foot in the street and the other in the Milky Way. And because now we're all adept, skilled readers, we all say, well, hold on a second, literally that cannot be the case. Regardless if his name is Saint, regardless whether he is an African American and a Cherokee Indian, he cannot literally have one foot in the street in New York City and the other in the Milky Way. Because we all get metaphor now, we say, what does that mean to have a foot in the Milky Way? Metaphorically, what does it mean? Good question, by the way. What does it mean? And this is what metaphors do. They shimmer for us. Tell me your name. So Sarah says, well, technically, I think you meant literally, we are, as citizens of the world, the Earth, which is part of the galaxy, which is part of the Milky Way, that technically, literally, he does have a foot in the Milky Way. Well done. And this is what metaphors do. They shimmer. They move back and forth. But on the other hand, literally, we might say, what would it look like if I could put my foot in the Milky Way? And we understand that language is working in both ways here, right? But it has good, a literal meaning here. But it also moves us out into thinking perhaps of other possibilities, other metaphorical possibilities. Yeah? Some of you are going to be more literal readers. Some people are more literal readers. Said about William Blake, the great English poet, that he was too literal of an imagination, William Blake. And that would suggest to us that perhaps William Blake wasn't a poet, but we know William Blake was a poet. So those of us who have more metaphorical readings of Milky Way and Sarah, this is just literature, getting something to settle in for one reading is not always going to be the answer. No more than we want it to be. Metaphor opens up the possibilities for language. Gives us more options to think about. What does it mean to have a foot in the Milky Way, metaphorically?
Limited by conventional modes of communication and expression.
Okay. So that's what a reading can mean. So Lindsay's reading a book about faint by having a foot in the Milky Way. Metaphorically is that he's not limited by convention. This is why he becomes Patti Smith's guide in this passage. We've already established here, haven't we, that Patti Smith isn't limited by her imagination. One more. Irony. There is a paragraph to read. I'll do this one. This one's 28. Been walking with Patti Smith, and they walk down McDougal Street in New York City. The saint is greeted by some of the people who are setting up cafes in the morning. They would say, hey, Saint, they would say, you keep the ship, or else they'll excuse you away. Got anything for me? He asked. The cooks knew him well and gave him offerings in brown paper bags. He returned the favor with anecdotes of his travels from the heartland to Venus. And that, of course, is just myth. He's literally traveling to Venus. And that throws us into the realm of metaphor. Telling stories about traveling to Venus, unless we think that Saint actually traveled to Venus. Which, you know, we walk to the park, sat on a bench, and divided his cake. Loaves of day-old bread and a head of lettuce. He had me remove the top layers of the lettuce and broke my bread in half. Some of the lettuce was still crisp inside. There's not in the lettuce leaves, he said. The bread will satisfy your hunger. We piled the best leaves. We piled the best leaves on the bread and happily ate. A real prison breakfast, I said. Yeah, a real treat. Real treat. In which we live, but perhaps it's a state of mind. That's how powerful the metaphor is. Even though you're trapped in Wild Hall, 9:25 in the morning, on Wednesday, the 25th subway, right, 20th subway, trapped, no break, metaphor. All right. The last time we started in on, and this is moving up to page 31, I just want to move through this real quickly. Last time we talked about the summer of 1967, which is the same summer that Patti Smith meets Saint, the same summer that she comes to New York City. And this lyrical moment at the end of this chapter. This is what freedom looks like for Patti Smith in New York City, 1967, page 31. When it got really tough, when it got really rough, I would go back to Pat. Hard courage. Occasionally bumping into someone I knew who would let me shower and sleep in it. Or else I'd sleep in the hall near a familiar door. That wasn't much fun, but I had my mantra, my mantra. I'm free. I'm free. After several days, I'm hungry. I wasn't worried though. I just needed a break. I wasn't going to give up. I grabbed my bag, suitcase from street to street, trying not to wear out my unwelcome. And here's the lyrical moment that we started on last time. My lyrical moment that I want you to think in terms of imagery, symbol, and metaphor, how these are woven together into this one paragraph. It was the summer Coltrane died, the summer of Christmas ship. Coward children raised their empty arms, and China exploded the H-bomb. Jimi Hendrix set his guitar in flames in Monterey. Literally, Jimi Hendrix did that. Literally. But it's also a metaphor for something else, right? AM radio played Ode to Billy Joel. There were riots in Newark, Milwaukee, and Detroit. It was the summer of Elvira Madigan, the summer of love. And there's Miami. In the summer of love, in the summer of 1967, summer of love. Milwaukee and Detroit. China was setting off the H bomb. Maplefolk's medium primarily photography. Did some other work with especially collages early on. The book tells us about how he proceeds from working with collages and cutting pictures out of magazines, putting together in collages and other kinds of piece performance artwork, into using a Polaroid camera initially, and then later on he gets a different kind of camera, a Polaroid. But if we're talking about his photographs are distinguished by a classic and formal aesthetic sensibility. That is. Maplefolk. In addition to everything else that we can say about his artwork, he's concerned with the beauty and the form of his subject. The beauty and the form. We see that in the flowers, right? He had a special kind of thing for flowers. It was the form of the flower, right? The form of the flower. If you haven't ever heard a power lily in your hand, think about those roses, right? The form of the rose. Those paired images of Maplefolk's hands. We know from the first photograph that was on the right-hand side, that this photograph challenged convention. And as we're going to see next time, some critics said, made some of Maple Brick's work offend categories, offend categories of art. So classicism and formalism and visual art involves symmetry and order. Image from Leonardo's sketchbook. One of the really, really iconic images in Western culture. The figure for the Renaissance man. Most famous drawing in Western civilization's history. Has symmetry, the privileges of human. At the center of this circle. It's balanced, and it's ordered, and it speaks to classicism. And also the form of the work of art. The classicism is both the clarity, symmetry, balance, and order. And these are the aspects about Maple Brick's work that we have to keep in mind. Even as we see those images that are groundbreaking, change-making photography. Formalism just emphasizes. When we're talking about formalism, we're talking about paying attention to the form of the thing, not the subject matter, but its form. Its form. One of the most well-known paintings, another iconic painting by the Dutch painter Johannes Vermeer. Painting in the 17th century, how many people have been down to the Young Museum in the last few weeks and seen this Vermeer? This is one of the iconic works of art in the world. Movies made about it, books written about it, and it is within 1 hour of us for another few weeks at the UNIV Museum. If you go down and see it, yes. Should you put yourself as Patty Smith was put face-to-face about, yes. How many of you, besides being in this classroom for the last few weeks, have been to Wild Hall for another event? Good. How many of you have been to one of the performance theaters? The music being played. Good. This is one of your opportunities. As a student at Sonoma State, we're in the first season of performances at Wild Hall. In part, you just have to trust what I'm going to tell you, what the press is saying, that these are the greatest artists living who are performing in this hall this year. And next, as a student at Sonoma State, you can obtain cheap tickets. Come and hear things that are unfamiliar to you. Learn about the world. Find out right here on this campus, something is happening that is groundbreaking, it's changing. Changing not only Sonoma State, changing not only this region, but changing aspects about the performing arts internationally, right here and now. Perhaps changing you. Get down to San Francisco. Go see this thing. Otherwise, you're going to have to go to Amsterdam. The motherland is here. Refuse to acknowledge. It's here and only here in San Francisco. Get down to the Young Museum. See this painting. Why is it so unique? But we're not here to talk about it from here. It's like a maple fork. A maple fork portraiture draws on the kind of formal aspects that we see in there with pearl earring. So, in his 1988 photograph of Isabella Rossellini, we're drawn to the kind of enigmatic glance, the look, the book. What we're thinking about is, in this image, which you've already seen, a photograph of Patti Smith, the cover of Forces. I'll read the passage here in a second. But going back to this, right? The attention to the lip, to the angle of the shoulders. So about this photograph on page 250 of Just Kids, Patti Smith is describing the day that she goes over to have this photograph taken. And it's all about the form of the thing, right? Robert came to talk to me on page 250. He was worried because it was very overcast. I finished getting dressed, black, take pants, white, socks, black, easier, added my favorite ribbon, and Robert brushed the crumbs off my black jacket. The light was already fading, as Skip said. We had no assistants. We never talked about what we would do or what it would look like. We would shoot it. I would be stunned. I had my look in mind. He had his light in mind. That was all. Sam's apartment was sparring all white and nearly empty with a tall avocado tree by the window overlooking Fifth Avenue. There was a massive prism that refracted the light, breaking it into rainbows cascading on the wall across from a white radiator. Robert placed me by the triangle that was part of the image. There's a white triangle that's been created by the light coming through the prism. It's a subtle aspect of form in this image. It's an important detail for how we see this image. Robert placed me by the triangle. His hand trembled slightly as he ready to shoot. I stood. The clouds kept moving back and forth. Something happened with his light meter, and he became slightly agitated. He took a few shots. He abandoned the light meter. A cloud went by, and the triangle disappeared. He said, "You know, I really like the whiteness of the shirt. Can you take the jacket off?" I flung my jacket over my shoulder, Frank Sinatra style. I was full of references. He was full of light and shadow. And with Frank Sinatra style, then we see that this image now alludes metaphorically to the history of great American singers, Frank Sinatra. In fact, he said, the triangle, "You took a few more shots. I got it. How do you know? I just know. You took 12 pictures that day." Within a few days, he showed me the contact sheet. "This one has the magic," he said. "When I look at it now, I never see me. I see us. I see us." Another classic image from the Sistine Chapel. Michelangelo's. This part of the chapel, this part, the famous image from that fresco on the ceiling, the Sistine Chapel. represented on the left of the image, reaching down in the act of creation, touching the finger of the human on the right hand side. God is in the act of creation. It's also metaphorically representing the act of creation and the act of the artist as creator. That idea of the artist as creator. That powerful, powerful notion that artists create things with their imagination. That romantic idea that we talked about before today. That artists, like God, create. Powerful, powerful idea. God reaching out. Notice that portrait of Robert Mayfield. The artist as creator. Right? Thank you.